Hi, this is Jim Pewter along with Darlene Love, and we're sharing some eggnog together as we reminisce from Christmas's past. It's only a few more days.
We haven't got much time.
No. And we're going to bring back some more memories with Darlene and the Crystals and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. And let's kick things off with a song that you sang background on with Dwayne Eddy and the Rebels. And were you a rebel at then?
No.
Bass guitar. Dwayne Eddy, along with Darlene Love and the Blossoms, and you're wailing away on that record.
That sounds really strange.
Does it sound strange? But you haven't heard that since you probably recorded it.
I haven't, and it's so high. I was sitting here trying to sing along with it, and it is high.
When you recorded that tune, was Dwayne Eddy's guitar part already on tape?
Everything was already recorded when we came into the studio.
Mm-hmm. And like I mentioned earlier in the week, it was kind of a new sound for Dwayne Eddy, because before this time he didn't have female singers on his
on just his fellas.
Yeah, right.
Hollering in the background.
The next record we're going to play is called He's a Rebel, and it was released under the name Crystals, and it just, well, a lot of rock historians have documented that you sang lead on it, and now I'm going to ask you, did you sing lead on this tune?
Yes.
All right, so that's cleared up. So everyone listening knows that Darlene Love is the lead voice on the song that Phil Spector produced, which became a number one song in 1962. It was written by Gene Pitney. And how was the song presented to you, Darlene?
Just as a background session. And Phil wanted to really know, I guess, if I could sing. And I started rehearsing with it, and he decided to let me do the lead on it.
Uh-huh. Did you know it was going to be released under the name Crystals?
Yes.
Okay, so that was all kind of...
out front,
yeah. The song is one of the most requested oldies, even today. And it's a song that could possibly be done over again. You never know. It's a lot of song. Every 10 years or so, someone will take a tune and redo it. But it had sort of a street feel at the time, didn't
right.
it?
Right. Yeah.
He's a Rebel. Darlene Love and the Crystals.
Just
She's a Rebel, Darlene Love and the Crystals. And this is Jim Pewter. We'll continue with some more memories with Darlene and some of the groups she sang with. Coming up, Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. In a garret somewhere in London in 1842, a young engraver's apprentice named William Eagley was thinking of a new way to share the Christmas spirit with his friends. He printed and sent out 100 copies of what may have been the first real Christmas card. It wasn't an elaborate affair, just a picture of a Christmas scene and simply worded greeting. Today, the Christmas card has become one of the most popular of holiday traditions around the world, but the thought behind even the most modern card is still Eagley's simple greeting, a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to you. The holiday season has been enriched by a store of traditions from many lands for all of us to share, as we share in our hearts the Christmas spirit of warmth and joy and the wish for peace on earth. With postage rates going up high, it's, you know, people aren't sending out as many cards as they did when we were younger.
I think so. Even as kids, we'd send out cards to our friends, but I don't think kids can afford to send them to their friends anymore.
It's always great to get a card from a young child, you know.
When right.
They get together with their Crayolas and they come up with something unique. Or is it? Just so they keep it on the card, not the wall.
They go off the card writing their name.
Next, we have a tune by Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, and Darlene Love sang with that group. She was one of the Blue Jeans, and they had several hit records that Phil Spector produced, and we're kind of reminiscing about the 60s with Darlene on our show during this holiday session and sound. This song was called Why Do Lovers Break Each Other's Hearts? And before we get into the tune, Darlene, were you a fan of some of the late 50s groups and singers? Did you like the rhythm and blues rock and roll sound as a young girl?
Oh yes, yeah. Some of my favorite groups were like the Dales, you know, who today is still one of my favorite groups because they did fantastic records.
Because what you did on a lot of your records with Phil is you took sometimes simple melodies and then with your talent singing them conveyed a whole new energy, but then Phil took the production and made it into a big sound, which was kind of ahead of its time.
That's right.
And I was just commenting while one of the records was on that Bruce Springsteen's concert show has that Phil Spector production to it.
Wall of sound.
That's what they call it. Let's get back to a memory with Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. Anything come to mind when you hear this tune again, Why Do Lovers Break Each Other's Hearts?
Levi's Today.
Why do lovers break each other's heart? Oh,
Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans with Darlene Love singing lead. While the record was on, you mentioned that Bobby Sox was singing, already had his voice down, and then
right.
What happened?
Phil didn't like the way he sounded on it by himself, so first he put Bobby's voice on, then he put mine right on top of Bobby's, and that didn't come out, so he just erased all of that and put my lead on, and then I overdubbed my voice two times.
Oh, I see. Like mm-hmm. You put the headset on and just sing
right.
Over your voice.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that, I guess that's just a natural timing people have to be able to do that right, to be able to get all the inflections just right. Was it just something that came natural for you when you first did
it? It was very difficult at first because I've never tried to overdub exactly what I did.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to listen to it, and then, you know, I would have to try to stay as close to what I did. If you notice on some of the parts, it might be a part going down and I went up.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a little difficult when you first started doing it because that was the first time I'd ever tried to match word for word what I was actually doing.
We're going to play another cut from the Christmas album that you did in 63. And this also features Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. And the song is The Bells of St. Mary's. Did you pick out this tune?
No, this is one of the ones we did as Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. And this is one of the songs that Bobby wanted to do.
I was just mentioning to Darlene that the Christmas album that she was featured on that was cut in 1963 still gets a lot of airplay around the world. In fact, the album featured yourself and the Crystals and the Ronettes and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. Disc jockeys today will play cuts from that album more than some of the traditional artists of the early 50s.
Which is nice.
It is. Keeps the name out front.
Right.
This is a unique arrangement of a standard. The Bells of St. Mary's. Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, along with Darlene Love, and that's the Bells of St. Mary's. She's my special guest all week on our holiday session in sound. And I was just looking here at an article that Todd Everett wrote on Darlene, very well put together. It's Love on the Rebound in Fountain Valley. That's on the West Coast. It's a club where Darlene's been working lately, club owned by
Bill Medley
of the Righteous mm-hmm. Brothers. Tell me a little bit, Darlene, about your family. Your father is a minister, is that right?
My father is a minister. He passed last year, but I have two brothers. that have a ministry also, and they each have their own churches now.
Oh, that's nice.
Which is nice, because I love gospel music. I love going to church.
There was an article, well, the article that Todd wrote on you here mentioned that Phil was a fan of gospel singer. What was her name?
Dorothy Love.
And then that's how your name came about?
It was. I didn't want to change my first name, and we were kind of going over what to use for a last name, and he asked me if I liked the last name Love, and he said it over and over again to get used to it, and I liked it, and I had it legally changed to Darlene Love.
And your name before?
My maiden name was Wright.
Any relationship to Arthur?
No.
No, okay, just wanted to know. Christmas from the past, as we're reminiscing now, we can kind of relate to a lot of things that have gone on down through the years. It's a time of a season that can be happy for some and not so happy for others, you know, especially when not everyone is here to share. But can you kind of take us back to a Christmas, you mentioned one earlier, but another time that was happy for you when everyone was kind of together?
I had never traveled away from home during the Christmas season. It was usually a time where if anything else was going on, you just didn't do it. We were all together. The family was together. And it was one of those kind of Christmases. I guess I was an early teenager, and we didn't have a whole lot. And my father and mother was asking us what we wanted, and it was one of those Christmas that they could not afford to get us anything, you know. So I don't know what they did. It used to be a joke in our family. My mother used to take her wedding ring and take it to the hawk shop and hawk it. We never knew this till we were grown adults away from home. They told us this story. And each of us got the thing that we wanted that Christmas. I wanted a watch, and I got that. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of things when you're younger you can relate to that you can't relate to anymore today.
That's
people
right.
Buy things today and put it on their credit cards and paid for those bills year after year after year.
I know. A Christmas will roll around, they're still paying for last year's gifts. I picked out a tune here from an album that was called Today's Hits in 63. This wasn't a hit single, but it features you on a tune called My Heart Beat a Little Bit Faster. And I started listening to this a month ago or so, you know, at home alone. And there's great feeling on this record. It comes across with very sincere, but also Phil's production on this is not as powerful sounding as some of the other things. You showcased your voice more on this particular record.
I think this song started out to be an instrumental.
Is that right?
And he changed his mind when we started singing with the words.
Yeah. My Heart Beat a Little Bit Faster with our guest, Darlene Love.
Never forget. One man. 'cause that's the weekend. Oh yeah.
Friday.
It's my lips and my
Darlene Love, My Heart Beat a Little Bit Faster. During the Christmas season, many holiday customs are observed in countries around the world. One of the oldest of all Christmas traditions is the display of nativity scene, or presepio, as it's called in Italy, where the customs originated. In many Italian homes, entire rooms are given over to this display, which contain hundreds of figures. German wooded carvers are especially famous for their hand-carved figurines. In Spain, the scene usually includes a stream with women washing clothes on the banks, but the central figures of the display are the same in every country: the stable, the wise men, the shepherds, and the child in the cradle. The Christmas season is rich in colorful traditions for all of us to share, and in our hearts we share something much deeper: the true spirit of Christmas, hope, joy, and the wish for peace on earth. Our special guest all week is Darlene Love of the Crystals, Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, and also of the Blossoms. And tomorrow we'll be showcasing some more memories on some tunes that Darlene sang on, and also some background sessions with the Righteous Brothers and Johnny Rivers. And it's like we're having four or five different people on the show, because you've been involved with so many groups down through the years. Do you reflect often on these days, the days we're playing now with the records and that?
Yes, we do. Sometimes, usually around the holiday time too. You sit down and pull out all the records, your friends come by, and we start laughing and joking about how we sounded. And it brings back a lot of memories, because those were good times.
When you're singing in a club today now, I imagine someone will come up to you and say, you know, I remember when you recorded this, or they'll ask for an autograph. Maybe they'll bring a 45 with them, you know, for you to sign. And you get calls, I imagine, sometime from people you don't know, but that want to know a little bit more about you from your records. That's always an experience that's kind of unique, isn't it?
It really is. It's nice to know that you're remembered. Uh-huh. At the club, people have been coming up to me asking for autographs, and they have these records that I've never seen before, and I'll ask them, where did you get this? And it's really nice that they take the time and the trouble to go out and find those records and bring them to me to autograph.
And it's amazing how they document a lot of your work that you forgot about.
Right.
And you'll pick up a book sometime, you know, on pop rock music, and there your name will be in a couple of pages about you. I didn't know
I was in so many.
We're going to move out with Duane Eddy and the Rebels, and then tomorrow we'll continue with some more of your hits, Darlene. And the reason we picked out Duane Eddy is because you did a lot of background work for him. In the early 60s, when he was incorporating a girl sound in the background with his guitar, this is one of his original instrumental hits called Bonnie Came Back. This is Jim Pewter along with Darlene Love, and we'll be back tomorrow. Until then, you keep it straight ahead. Bye-bye. Hi, this is Jim Pewter, along with Darlene Love of the Crystals and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans and the Blossoms. Darlene's been with us all week, and it's been a lot of great memories, and we're sharing a special Christmas Eve with you right now. Got some tunes lined up with the Righteous Brothers and Johnny Rivers and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans. And I thought we'd kick things off, Darlene, with a song that we recorded quite a few years ago called Christmas, Baby, Please Come Home. So if there's someone special out there thinking about trying to get home, it'll be soon, someday, right?
Someday.
Darlene Love, everyone. Baby, Please Come Home with Darlene Love. Who's playing piano on those on that date?
Leon Russell.
And we all know who Leon is. And in the days, in the 60s, on the Phil Spector sessions, he was the piano man.
Right.
And a lot of that stuff he would improvise, wouldn't he?
Especially like on this one, I was telling you before that you should hear the part of this record that was cut off. He did some fabulous keyboard things on this.
Mm-hmm. Besides being a featured singer, and also doing a lot of background singing for major recording artists, is there any other type of career you might have pursued beside that? Anything you wanted to be, maybe beside like a singer and a performer?
There was a time when I thought about being a disc jockey or a reporter that talked. But it was funny. The words sometimes that disc jockeys have to say are names. You know, I wondered a lot of times if they practice how to say those words, because some of the names, I don't even know how they get them out.
Yeah, what on the news release that comes out on the UPI and all that, they have everything broken down sometimes phonetically for them if it's a foreign name or whatever. So but sometimes they just read it cold, and then
right.
there'll be a name that they'll say five or six different times, the pronunciation of it. And it used to always be that if Walter Cronkite said it a particular way, that's the way it should be did, you know, so they'd watch.
That's pretty good.
Watch him and listen to what how he would pronounce it. We have a tune by the Righteous Brothers next on our show. You're My Soul and Inspiration. Early on in the week, we played a couple of their other recordings that you were singing background on, Little Latin Loop-E-Loo, and You've Lost That Love and Feeling. I imagine you did the others too, like Unchained Melody and Ebb Tide.
Right, and you know, I don't know if anybody knows, but Bill Medley produced that album, Soul and Inspiration, also. Phil Spector only recorded Love and Feeling.
That's right, because Bobby and Bill left Phil's label and they went to Verve, I believe.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that's right, if you look at the 45s, it's produced by Bill Medley.
Right.
And in a way, it showed that Bill could musically take what Phil had done and create it in his own way also.
Right. Yeah. He recorded me. He was my record producer for a while also.
Oh, is that right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. This tune here, You're My Soul and Inspiration, became a number one song for the Righteous Brothers in 1966. And did you do a lot of tours with them around this time?
For 2 years, the Blossoms traveled with the Righteous Brothers as their opening act.
And that was,
we did their background also.
In the United States.
Right.
Yeah. This Canada. Is a great tune. Yeah. A lot of feeling on this one. Here's the Righteous Brothers.
Girl, I can't let you do this. Let you walk away. Girl, how can I live through this?
My Soul and Inspiration, the Righteous Brothers. When they were singing on stage, I imagine it would get quite loud, wouldn't it?
It would be. They used to do a funny thing when Bobby used to do his talk part, and they would be playing up to one another, and Bill would come to that part, baby, and he would just scream it in Bobby's ear, and he would go through all the gyrations of, wait a minute, you heard in my ear. It was hysterical.
I read somewhere where people who do a lot of performing and work behind a lot of or in front of a lot of amplification with guitars and whatever, that it, you know, has an effect on your hearing through the years.
It does. One thing about Phil, when we left his sessions, it would take a couple of hours for our ears to come back down to normal because he played all the playback so loud. Mm-hmm. And people don't know that's really damaging to the ears.
Mm-hmm. There's some record producers, I'm sure you know, Darlene, that will, instead of playing it back at full blast on a large speaker, they'll listen to a little speaker and they'll say, well, this is how the car radio sounds.
Right.
And that's the way when kids buy records, 45s are going to hear it on a smaller speaker.
That's the way I was fascinating to hear that once. I was in the studio and this little bitty box And Bill had his ear just laid down to it, listening to it. And I asked him, what was he doing that for? And he told me the reason what you just said. It would come through the radio like that.
Nowadays, they have such sophisticated equipment. You know, it's like I just got a small record player at home. People come over, where's your stereo? Where's your big, you know, system? And when Dean Torrance was in here a while back, you know, he says at times he has just a little record player and that's all. You know, a lot of people think because you're in the radio or television or recording business, you have, you know, the great stereo system. And usually it's the other way around. The people that listen, you know, that aren't in it have the big systems.
$1,000 worth of equipment.
Darlene Love is my guest. This is Jim Pewter on our Christmas Eve show. And coming up, we're going to talk about Johnny Rivers and that album that you might have called Johnny Live at the Whiskey A Go-Go. He used to sing there, but the album wasn't really live, and we'll find out what all that means. On Christmas Eve, a midnight mass is held in many churches around the world, and after this service, a very special celebration takes place in French and Spanish homes. In France, it's called La Réveillon, a family gathering which lasts into the early morning. The family celebration in Spain is very much the same, a little noisier, perhaps thanks to all the noisemakers which are given to the children. And the experience, though, is the same in any language, an experience of the heart, a spirit of joy, and the hope for peace, which is the true meaning of Christmas throughout the world. Darlene Love sang with the Crystals and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans and also her own group, the Blossoms, and they were featured on the Shindig television shows and also the Tammy show, which had James Brown and Jan and Dean, and that's on television now from time to time. That was one of the first concerts, I think, that they shot on stage and then for a theatrical distribution, wasn't it?
Right, it was the first of its kind.
You also did some work with Johnny Rivers producer Lou Adler, and we're going to play a tune here that was written by Chuck Berry called Memphis, and this was Johnny Rivers' first hit in 64. And tell me about how you were involved with Rivers and Lou Adler. Lou wanted to have a live kind of effect for the records, and what did he do?
Right, this is, I guess, during the time maybe you'd go into a nightclub and record your album live. And a lot of times they would have to come back in the studio to redo it to make sure the sound and everything was right. And that's what Phil wanted to do, not Phil, but Lou wanted to do. So what he did, he got all of us together and some of his friends and kind of set up like a nightclub atmosphere in the studio. And we sat in the background and made a lot of noise. It got funny because after a while, after a couple of drinks, it really sounded like we were in a nightclub.
You can hear the glasses tinkling and everything.
Give me Memphis, Tennessee. Help me find a party to try to get in touch with me. She could not leave a number, but I know who placed the call. Cause my uncle took the message and he wrote it on the wall. Help me, information, get in touch with my Marie. She's the only one who'd call me if I'm Memphis, Tennessee. Her home is on the south side, high up on the ridge, just a half a mile from the Mississippi Bridge. Tennessee. Help me, information, more than that I cannot add. Only that I miss her and all the fun we had. Marie is only 6 years old. Information, please.
try to put me through to her in Memphis, Tennessee.
There they are. Johnny Rivers, along with Darlene Love and Friends, and Lou Adler. That was Memphis. And you did a whole series of records, the background kind of a thing with them, didn't
right,
you?
Right, uh-huh. Yeah, it went on and on. We did a lot of great things that the Four Tops had recorded that he redid, that Johnny redid, oh, which were fantastic.
Yeah, Baby, I Need Your Lovin'.
Right, mm-hmm.
How was Johnny to work with? Was he a perfectionist in the studio?
He was, because he was a musician also, and he knew what he wanted, and him and Lou would get together and work it out. And he kind of depended upon us as background singers to come up with the right thing. But he was kind of low-keyed, but he knew what he wanted.
You know, it's amazing that when I'm listening to all the records that you were singing on, I think in the business, the music business, once you have some success, everyone wants to utilize part of that success. It's like, well, the Blossoms sang on this record, that was it, we'll have them do this one, and then it just kind of sort of snowballed, I guess.
It did, it really did snowball, because we had so much work. Lou told us, why don't you change your prices? Everybody's using you, so it's just like anything else. So we started charging double scale and to try to price ourselves out of a lot of the work, because we couldn't handle it all. We were even giving it away, but it didn't do any good. And when we doubled our price, our work tripled. So it didn't really do any good. We were just making more money.
I heard one time that you did some work for Lou Adler and Herb Alpert in the early days when they were just getting started. I mean, you were at like $10 or $15 a session.
Right.
And what did Lou say to you then?
He told us if he ever made it as a producer, he would make it up to us for all those favors. And he did.
He did. Here's another one you sang on with Johnny Rivers.
Is only one, and I'm a one. I'm a one. I'm a one. I'm a one. The one to call the seventh son. I can tell your future, it will come to pass. I can do things to you, make your heart feel glad. Look in the sky, predict the rain. Tell when a woman's got another man. I'm a one. Sweet, they will even make your little heart skip a beat. Heal a sick, raise a dead, make the little girls talk out of their heads. I'm a one. Oh, I'm a one. I'm a one, I'm a one. I wanna call a seven son. A beat, heal a sick, raise a dead, and make the little girls talk out of their heads. I'm a one. Oh, I'm a one. I'm a one, I'm a one. I'm a one to call a seventh son.
The Blossoms, along with Johnny Rivers, on a hit single that he had in 1965, that's Seventh Son. During the holiday season, many Christmas customs and traditions are shared by countries around the world. For example, it's a well-known fact that the worldwide consumption of candy rises remarkably at Christmas time. The children are usually held responsible for this phenomena, but the older folks are equally guilty. Nobody's ever found a real practical solution to this enjoyable state of affairs, and what more, nobody wants to. Not while there's English mince pie, gingerbread from Germany, cassata from Greece, Swedish rice pudding, and candy canes in the United States. The list is as endless as it is tempting. In sharing our Christmas traditions with others, we also share an experience of the heart, a spirit of joy and the hope for peace on earth, which is the true meaning of Christmas throughout the world. A lot of candy in the socks coming up, huh? Yeah, got everything all ready to go?
Just about. I'm just about finished.
Yeah, all the shopping is done.
Yes.
Yeah. We're just sharing some eggnog on Christmas Eve with Darlene Love of the Crystals and Bobby Socks and the Blue Jeans and the Blossoms. It's like we got 15 people here, but just one lady, one lady's talking. I got a tune here called Here Comes Santa Claus. And Gene Autry, I think, wrote this.
I think yeah. You never know where it's going to come from.
And this is from the Phil Spector Christmas album that we've been featuring all week long with Darlene Love. And Bobby Socks and the Blue Jeans was the group she sang with at this time. And Bobby Sheen singing on this particular tune. And you mentioned that you went in and you had a choice in picking out some of these tunes.
Yes, for the first time.
This is a song that I think we can all relate to. Do you remember the first time when you were kind of waiting for Santa, looking out, you know, through the window and hoping he would arrive, trying to hear something on the roof?
Right. I believed in Santa Claus during those days. The kids today, they know there's not a Santa Claus, so they don't get that beautiful fantasy anymore. Yeah.
Well, he's coming tonight, though. That's it. Here comes Santa Claus with Bobby Socks and the Blue Jeans, and this is Jim Pewter along with Darlene Love. And you enjoy trimming the Christmas tree every year?
I really do. I try to get together with my children, and they make a lot of things for the tree, and that's a lot of fun doing it that way.
And when you pack it away, you have to kind of remember where certain things go, because when you open it up, you know, each year.
Label it. I label everything that I put away.
And the Christmas tree, I remember one year we'd have one that would be very big, and then the next one you decide, well, we'll get a smaller one this year, and you have to find a place to put it because there's not much room, you know.
Right.
And then the kids will come down maybe a couple days beforehand, and they'll want to open up a certain package. They'll know what something is, you know, and think, is it this? Is it this? No, just wait. You just got to wait. Tomorrow on Christmas Day, we'll be featuring some more memories with Darlene Love. We'll have to do Ron Ron and The Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans with Darlene will be back, and then we'll talk about some of the early days with Sam Cooke. That'll be coming up tomorrow. Time now for another one of your hits. We don't have too much time because the show goes so fast. This is A Fine, Fine Boy. Do you remember it?
Yes, I do.
With Darlene Love.
My boy. I got so much love in my heart for him that I really don't feel like me when he's not around. Yes, there are boys and there are boys, but he's a
fine, fine boy.
Jim Pewter, moving out with Darlene Love on a special time. And we'll see you tomorrow on Christmas.
I'll be here.
All right. Jim Pewter and Darlene Love. Till tomorrow. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Jim Pewter, 2301 Friday.
This is Jim Pewter, along with Darlene Love of the Crystals, and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, and also the Blossoms. We want to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Yes, I do wish everyone a Merry Christmas.
And we want to announce our engagement.
Yeah, after a week.
Yeah, after a week. Here's Darlene and the Crystals. Run in your ear on Christmas with Darlene Love and the Crystals. And I know if you have that record at home, it doesn't say Darlene Love on the label, but she was the lead singer of that tune. And that was a song that's been covered by a lot of people down through the years. Mm-hmm. I even have a recording.
Here lately.
Yeah, Laverne and Shirley even recorded right. that.
What is his name, Cassidy?
David?
David Cassidy, uh-huh. I think, recorded this. One of them recorded
it. Oh, I know who it was. Sean Cassidy.
Sean Cassidy,
he had a hit on it. That's right.
A couple years ago.
That's right. How's everything been this week for you on Christmas?
It's been good. It's been good. I'm through with everything, and everything really went good.
And I want everyone to know that Darlene Love is singing in clubs again, and she's going to be having some new material out soon, and you'll be hearing it on our show. And it's been just great spending Christmas week with her, and she's with us now on a special day. And we're going to bring back some more memories in your career with Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, and you were singing on this particular hit also called Not Too Young to Get Married. Bobby Sheen was the name of the fellow who sang lead on a lot of the records with the Blue Jeans and along with yourself. Do you ever see him from time to time?
I talk to Bobby at least two or three times a month. I still see him. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's working now with the Coasters, and he does a lot of lead with them. It's only one original Coaster in the group. But they've gotten together, and that's who he's working with now.
Yeah. This has sort of a party feel, like a Gary U.S. Bonds kind of record.
Right. Yeah. That's how it started out, too.
My mama said I can't see you no more, 'cause we don't know what love really means.
Yeah, what you mean we don't know what love means?
says we can't get married for 3 years or more. Cause we're only in our teens. Oh no, we're not too young, young to get married. Not too young, young to get married. What kind of difference can a 2 year make? Got a heavy now, or my heart will break. Not too young, young to get married. Not too young, young to get married. I could love you more than I do today.
You're just listening for the bass there. Not too young to get married. And a lot of people get married this time of the year, get engaged, what
right.
have you. So we wish them all the best.
Me and you.
That's right. We should have a party after. You're all invited. Here's the place to call. This is Jim Pewter along with Darlene Love, and we're going to reminisce with Sam Cooke on a record that Darlene sang background on in just a few seconds. The Christmas season has many special meanings for all of us. In different countries, the customs and traditions may vary, but the basic spirit remains the same. In Sweden, for example, the holiday season begins on St. Lucia Day, December 13th. In hundreds of thousands of Swedish homes, the youngest daughter becomes a Lucia queen, dressed in a flowing white gown with a crown of leaves and lighted candles. In the darkness before dawn, she tiptoes through the house, awakening each member of the family with a song, serving them coffee and freshly baked cakes in bed. By understanding and sharing the Christmas traditions of others, we share something much deeper, an experience of the heart. For the true message of Christmas is the same in any language, a message of hope and the wish for peace and goodwill among the people and nations of the earth. This is about the time of the year, I think, when the only time I ever have mincemeat pie is now.
Right.
And around Thanksgiving, turkey. I have turkey a couple of times a year, but mincemeat pie is the only time around Christmas, and then the cranberries, too.
Mm-hmm.
So there's certain kind of foods that we have just during this time of the year. And it's a special time to be with family and friends and to the people that can't be around their loved ones. At least we are communicating our love right to their ears right now. Everybody likes to cha-cha-cha. How's that for a segue? When you were singing with the Blossoms back in the late 50s, early 60s, earlier in the week, we showcased a tune you were on with Ed Townsend, For Your Love, 58. And then you started doing some work with Sam Cooke, didn't you?
Yes, which was really nice. I met Sam Cooke in my senior year of high school, and he was such a big star then. It was really a great thrill to even be able to do background for him or to be in the same room that he was in. It was nice.
A unique artist, and his songs sound even great today, the style he had, which he came out of the gospel
mm-hmm.
sound, didn't he, with the soul stirs.
Right.
And can you just kind of describe maybe what a Sam Cooke session might have been like in the late 50s? What kind of atmosphere prevailed?
During that time, the musicians were still live, which was still nice. We had the musicians were right in the room with us. And so you could really get a great feel because the singers and Sam and the musicians were there. So it was a lot of kidding going on before the sessions and in the breaks. So it gave you a great feel of being really there while the record was being created.
Mm-hmm. And Robert Bumps Blackwell, who's been a close friend of mine through the years. In fact, Darlene, he got me in the business when I was just a kid.
Really?
Yeah, I met Sam and Little Richard around this time also. And he's a unique talent, the way he produced some of the early sides, like the one we're going to hear, and You Send Me and Wonderful World. Now, you were singing on this particular record, Everybody Likes to Cha-Cha-Cha.
Right. Yeah. With the blossoms.
Yeah. Here's mm-hmm. Darlene Love. Listen in the background. Here's Sam Cooke from 1959.
Everybody loves to cha-cha-cha. Little children like to cha-cha-cha. They like to cha-cha-cha. They like to cha-cha-cha. Ooh. Everybody likes to cha-cha-cha. Took my baby to the hop last night. And what to my surprise, when we got there, she hit me with the news right between the eyes. Yeah, she said she couldn't do the cha-cha-cha. She said she couldn't do the cha-cha-cha. She couldn't, no, she couldn't cha-cha-cha. Ooh, my baby couldn't do the cha-cha-cha. I told her not to worry, they'd play some other dance. But we sat there for an hour and a half, and we never got a chance. For every song they played was the cha-cha-cha. Every song they played was the cha-cha-cha. Tom Dooley, Chief-a-Two, cha-cha-cha. Ooh. Every number was the cha-cha-cha. I told her not to worry, there's only one thing we can do. Baby, if you let me take you by the hand, I'm gonna teach this dance to you. Then I taught her one, two, cha-cha-cha. One, two, cha-cha-cha. And up now, cha-cha-cha. Baby, and back now, cha-cha-cha. That's right, turn now, right, let's cross now. Ooh. I taught my baby how to cha-cha-cha. We kept on dancing, and was I surprised, for you see, for a little while, she was doing it better than me. Now my baby loves to do the cha-cha-cha. Ooh, she loves to do the cha-cha-cha. She likes the cha-cha-cha. Ooh, she likes the cha-cha-cha. Ooh, everybody likes the cha-cha-cha. They do it one, two, cha-cha-cha. All right, one, two, cha-cha-cha. And up now, cha-cha-cha. All right, back now. All right, baby, let's cross now.
That's his sound, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
Sam Cooke. Darlene Love is my guest. This is Jim Pewter doing a little cha-cha-cha on Christmas. We can bring on the twist now and the stroll and all those records. Yeah. Everybody likes to cha-cha-cha. Loves to, as a matter of fact. Next, we have Al Casey and the Blossoms. And the Blossoms, of course, that's Darlene Love. And this song was called Surfin' Hootenanny. And Al Casey was with Duane Eddy and the Rebels.
Right.
And even further back, he was on a record called The Fool with Sanford Clark, a rockabilly record. And he did a lot of work with Lee Hazelwood, and so did Darlene around this time. This is sort of a unique sound because it was similar to the Duane Eddy records, the Boss Guitar, which we played earlier in the week with the Blossoms, and Dance with a Guitar Man. And on this particular record, you'll hear Darlene and the Blossoms mention the Ventures and Dick Dale and Duane Eddy, and then Al Casey will do a little guitar part there that kind of reminds you of them and their style. And imagine this is a tune, you probably don't even have this record, do you?
A lot of these songs I don't have, which, you know, it's nice to hear them again because you can sit down and laugh, you know, because they do really bring back a lot of memories. Mm-hmm. You forget over the years all the records you record.
Yeah. And this was on a label called Stacy Records, sort of a small label out of Chicago. And it features the guitar sound of Al Casey and Darlene Love and the Blossoms.
We're gonna have a
That's Al Casey along with Darlene Love and the Blossoms. You didn't know Darlene was a surfer, did you? And that's called Surfin' Hootenanny. The Christmas season is celebrated in many different ways around the world, but the basic spirit, the Christmas spirit, is the same in any language. The giving of gifts is one of the most universal of holiday customs, although it's observed on different dates in different countries. In most parts of Europe, the children receive their gifts on St. Nicholas Day, December 6th, but the adults wait until Christmas or New Year's. Scandinavian families usually open their presents on Christmas Eve, while in England and the United States, the traditional time is Christmas morning. And in Italy and Spain, the day for gift-giving is Epiphany, January 6th. Each country has its own traditions, but the true meaning of Christmas is always the same, the undying hope for peace between nations and goodwill among all men. And Darlene Love is my guest, and I hope your Christmas is happy. I know it is. I can tell by your face.
Yes, it is.
Healthy and everything. And Darlene Love will be on the recording scene real soon again. We'll keep you up to date on some of her new releases. Right now we're kind of reminiscing in the past with songs that she sang with the Crystals and Bobby Sox and the Blue Jeans, Sam Cooke. We had Al Casey doing Surfin' Hootenanny with the Blossoms. And next we have a tune called Want Ads by the Honeycone. And you tell me who the Honeycone was.
The Honeycones were three ladies in which the lead singer of the group was my sister, Edna Wright, which is really nice because, see, I started my sister in the business doing background. And she was on some of the early Phil Spector tunes. And she launched her own career as one of the Honeycombs.
Yeah, they had another hit called Stick Up, wasn't it?
Stick Up, right. One Monkey.
That's right. Yeah, I played
that. And they had
that.
About four, I think, big hit, large hits.
Mm-hmm. What is she doing today?
She's at home being a mother.
Ah.
Her husband, who was the producer of mostly all of these records, who wrote them, they got married, and now she's at home having children.
Mm-hmm. Let's reminisce with Darlene Love's sister, the Honeycone. That's what they were known as in 1970 or 71. It was around
71.
That time.
71.
Yeah. This is Want Ads. Let's reflect.
Want it. Young man, single and free. Experience in a love preferred, but we'll accept a young trainee. Oh, we're gonna put it in the want ads. I need a love that's true. Gonna put it in the want ads. My man and I are through. At home I find myself lost and all alone.
That's the Want Ads. Darlene Love's sister singing lead with a honeycomb, and they had several hits. That was a million seller, wasn't it, Darlene?
Yes, it was.
Want Ads.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a lot of music kind of reverberating off of your walls at your home all the time?
Yes, all the time. Matter of fact, I have a little boy that tries to play my albums, and I won't allow it because I take very, very good care of my records.
Yeah, because little kids, a lot of times, they won't put it back in the sleeves.
Right, or they handle it or throw it on the floor.
Uh-huh.
They don't know.
Do you play any musical instrument?
No, and I could kick myself a million times. When I was young, of course, everybody, I think, took piano lessons, and I took them for about 2 years, and my mother and father weren't the type of people, if we didn't want to do it, they would, you know, wouldn't make us. And unfortunately, I never picked it up again. I love music, but I've never, whenever I thought I was going to have the time to really go back to school or really to learn, the time just went away. And you need time, and I just can't seem to find it.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you do sessions today, do you kind of like sight read the charts, the musical charts that they have in front of you?
Right.
Yeah.
They have the charts already made out for us. And I have learned how to sight read over the years,
mm-hmm.
which helps.
Yeah. Recording techniques and the studios have changed so much, haven't they, since the early 60s?
Yes, they have. They really have.
Do you miss the spontaneity of doing things live and maybe the four-track as compared to what they're into now, 24 and just so many, you know?
Everything is done so this and this and this and this. You know, everything is done just so. Back in those days, it wasn't like that, you know. You would sing. If you didn't do it right, you could redo it maybe one or two times. But now, today, they do it over and over for weeks and months, you know, until they get it right.
Let's bring on another song from the Christmas album that you did in 63 that Phil Spector produced. This is called Marshmallow World. It's Marshmallow World. Here's some more memories with little Bobby Ray. Thank you. Little Bobby Ray, and this is Jim Pewter along with Darlene Love, and the time has gone by so quickly, and a lot of great memories with all the people you've worked with through the years, and I want to thank you for spending our Christmas week together.
Thank you, it was really nice.
And I know a lot of people have become more aware of your music now after listening to you tell the stories behind the hits, and a lot of times people aren't aware of all the work that you've done.
Right.
And it continues to live on and made a lot of people happy through the years.
It was good, and I still keep in touch with a lot of those people. Yeah.
Merry Christmas to you, Darlene. You're a beautiful and talented lady. And
thank you. Same to you.
And I thank you.
Here's Herbie Alpert. He's a beautiful
person. Yeah. Oh, yeah. He was one of my $5 sessions.
Keep it straight ahead. Bye-bye.